morning. My name is Blake Scanlon, and I'm the co-director of the Stanford VA California Alzheimer's Center. This morning, I'm very excited to introduce Dr. Rob Oldham. He currently serves as health officer, medical director, and director of public health for Placer County. He is also the current president of the California Conference of Local Health Officers and governor's appointee to the California Tobacco Education and Research Oversight Committee, vice chair of the California Medical Association's Council on Science and Public Health, and is on the board of Western Sierra Medical Clinics, the California Health Collaborative, and the Placer Nevada County Medical Society. Rob received a Bachelor's of Arts from the University of Virginia and his MD from the University of Alabama School of Medicine, and an MS in Public Health and Health Administration from Virginia Commonwealth University, where he also completed his residencies in general psychiatry and preventative medicine / public health. He completed a fellowship in psychosomatic medicine at Oregon Health Sciences University and was a health policy fellow with the Lister Hill Center for Health Policy. Dr. Oldham is board certified in general psychiatry, general preventative medicine and public health, psychosomatic medicine, and medical quality. He lives in Roseville with his wife and four daughters. Please remember to write questions for Dr. Oldham down on the cards, and then we will collect them for the Q&A panel next. I'd like to introduce you to Dr. Robert Oldham.
Thanks, Blake. Thank you, Blake. And are we doing okay on sound? Is that all right? Good. All right, so thanks so much for the introduction, and thanks for the invitation to come. This is my first time at this conference, and I'm just really impressed, one, by kind of the attendance, and wanted to thank the conference organizers. It's been very well organized. I'm doing a lot of speaking in this gig as the president of our California Conference of Local Health Officers, and so thanks so much. I know how much work goes into this, and appreciate that. Just a show of hands, we were talking, I know there are a few people here from local public health. Do we have anyone in the audience? So a few. Ruth was saying, Alzheimer's and dementias are increasingly on the lips of people in public health, but I think we have a long way to go. So our goal for maybe next year is to have more of us here, and maybe I can enlist the people in this room to go back to your local communities and get your public health people more interested in Alzheimer's and dementias, but also in maybe coming to this conference and having ongoing dialogue. So that's kind of my job for today, is to try to talk more about what the local public health resources are and how we can engage around Alzheimer's. And I'm just going to, my immediate job is to figure out this clicker here. So. There we go. Easy enough, I think. So some learning goals, like I said, first I want to talk about public health just a little bit, because I guess that's what I know best. I'm not a dementia researcher expert, although I thought I wanted to be that, actually. So 20 years ago, almost to the day, I applied to medical school thinking I'm going to be an addiction psychiatrist and to do health services research and other basic science research into dementias. I had a beloved grandmother who had just passed away from a long struggle with Alzheimer's disease, and so that was sort of in my core. One of the things, just reflecting on the state of research right now, and I think gets to my story of why I went from psychiatry and really mainly doing public health now, I'm doing some psychiatric practice, is this idea of not just for dementias, but also for other serious mental illnesses. I was delivering care on a one-by-one, family by family, and saw these huge impacts. And so I kind of recognize there's a role for being involved in policy, but also in system change to address kind of big public health issues, and that we can't just do it one individual at a time, although direct care is also very important. So anyway, my goal for today is to talk a little bit about public health, but then really talk about kind of what we do and maybe how we can partner together to address dementia, and then ending on kind of talking about some of the best practices in addressing dementias and suggesting some future directions to facilitate more effective public health approaches to dementia. So first, just what is public health starting? This is a definition from the Institute of Medicine that's old, but an oldie but a goodie, I think. It's what we as a society do to collectively assure the conditions in which people can be healthy. So as opposed, again, to direct, I still have to explain to my mother and family, what it is that, are you a real doctor? What do you do? Public health is assuring that there's healthcare delivery, that we have appropriate healthcare systems in place, but largely not delivering the care ourselves. And so I think this is important when we talk about applications to dementias. Dementia as a public health problem, I'll kind of skip to the chase and tell you I think that dementia is a public health problem, but then I'm going to go back and kind of talk more about that and explain my reasoning, because I think there's a lot of people who still need to be convinced of this, and again, trying to enlist the lots of people in this room to go out and try to talk about that at the local level. So first, what do we mean by a public health problem? I think it's the extent to which the problem impacts large numbers of people and vulnerable populations or public health systems. And so when we talk about large numbers of people, so for instance, when I was in psychiatric practice, generally a panel for one psychiatrist, you might see 200 to 400 patients in your panel of people who you're providing treatment for. In primary care, it's a little larger now, maybe in the 1,000 to 2,000 range. Me as a public health officer for Placer County, which is a medium-sized county, I kind of see my patient population as 400,000, all of our residents, and statewide approaching in the tens of millions, so maybe 40 million people. So kind of adding some zeros to that. So going from about 400 patients as an individual practitioner to 400,000, or even at the state level, closer to 40 million. So we have to scale our responses up and recognizing that there are different interventions at the individual level, at the local level, at the state level, and even at the national level. So the second point, so what makes something a public health problem, is the extent to which our public health approaches, which I'll describe a little bit more later, those approaches and resources actually match the problem. So as an example, there may be some conditions that are really prevalent that impact large numbers of people. One that just came to mind was, I'm a psychiatrist, so sometimes you have a dirty mind, is erectile dysfunction, right? So you see all the ads on TV. It affects large numbers of people, but really that's an individual care. I don't know that there are huge public health resources that can go to address that problem. Sorry, I had to, it's morning. Make sure everyone's awake here. So dementia has an impact, I'll argue again that it is a public health problem because we've already talked about this on this morning. One, the impact on large populations of people, which we've already talked some about and I'll talk more about, but also on vulnerable populations and on public health systems. Particularly, it's already been cited that Alzheimer's is the sixth leading cause of death in the United States. In California, probably higher than that. That's one of the problems. We don't know exactly what it is. We don't really have the surveillance systems to be able to answer some of these questions. But 6 million Americans are currently living with Alzheimer's, and as was stated earlier, projected to grow to 14 million by 2050. And some of these numbers have also been talked about this morning, African Americans being twice as likely to have dementia, Latinos about 1.5 times as likely. But at the same time, a lot of these groups are less likely to actually be diagnosed by their doctors. So that has a disproportionate impact. Already talked about women and how about 2/3 of people with dementia are women, and it's not just because they live longer. There's probably some other explanations, biological and otherwise. And that these groups, whether people with lower education, socioeconomic disadvantage, have probably a higher risk of getting dementia, but also when they have dementia, it has a disproportionate impact on them. So again, has a disproportionate impact on vulnerable populations. And then this is really the big one, I think the most compelling reason why I think it's a a serious public health problem that we need to be addressing yesterday is this impact on public health systems, particularly going forward with, you know, the baby boomers are, I think more and more of baby boomers are in their 70s, and in the next decade, probably moving into their 80s, and we're not really ready for that on the scale for our public health systems to address. So more than 95% of people with dementia have more than one chronic medical condition, which makes the need for really complex care coordination. About 1,500 ER visits per year for every 1,000 Medicare beneficiaries with dementia, and the total cost of Alzheimer's and dementias are estimated to be $250 billion a year. And these costs are expected to grow up to over $1 trillion by 2050. And again, for Medicare, currently about $140 billion per year, and a fifth of all Medicare dollars are spent on dementias. It's projected to be a third of the Medicare budget by 2050. And then for Medicaid, and so this is one of the reasons why I'll say public health has not been as involved in addressing Alzheimer's and dementia, is typically public health works with the safety net population. So we really know Medicaid. We don't work that much with Medicare. But I think increasingly this is becoming a Medicaid issue as well. Medicaid often, you know, it's the system for the most poor, sort of the safety net. But as people, you know, their assets get wound down, they move into long-term care, and that's a huge cost. If we don't take care of people and keep them in their homes, it'll bankrupt the Medicaid system. Dementias will bankrupt the Medicaid system as well, just in long-term care costs. So the next question is, to what extent are public health approaches and resources useful in addressing dementia? So first, what is the public health approach? We do things like data surveillance and analysis, promoting healthy lifestyles, building capacity in communities to address important public health challenges, including really asking the community what are your priorities. So we tend not to go out and work in a community on an issue that the community doesn't think is a priority. It's really a central tenet of public health. And so, by the way, when we get to what you can do, often we'll do community health assessments, and in most jurisdictions, Alzheimer's and dementias aren't coming up to the top of things that we need to be working on. And it's not because they're not there, that they're not huge impacts everywhere in this state. They are. I think it's the voice. Sometimes we don't include the advocacy community around Alzheimer's. So that's, I think, something we could do today, is start to pull local advocacy groups around Alzheimer's and dementias into our local public health planning processes. And I mentioned before, so increasingly the public health approach really is focusing on what we call health equity. So focusing on the most vulnerable populations and trying to improve their health status, especially groups that have been victims of racism and historical biases that have caused, really added to their disproportionate negative health impacts. So some common resources and approaches. One, in California, we have a great state health department. The state health department generally doesn't run a lot of programs. The local health departments run the programs. The state sort of takes the money and divides it up and gives some general parameters. So the local, we do have a local health department in every county in California, and then in three cities, Pasadena, Long Beach, and Berkeley. So 61 different jurisdictions, so we're everywhere. Common programs, communicable disease control and prevention, maternal child health, children's medical services, emergency preparedness and response, and chronic disease and injury prevention programs. We don't have dedicated funding to do Alzheimer's and dementia. I think we're working on that, right? And I think the governor's budget this year, there's a small amount going to pilots and to have dedicated programs in local health departments. But we have, I think there's a real opportunity, and I can talk more about this in a minute, about all the different programs that we have and to weave in a scope into their scopes of work to address Alzheimer's and dementia. So for instance, we do communicable disease control and prevention. We have surveillance systems for those types of illnesses. We could really improve our surveillance systems for dementias using those resources with maybe just a little bit more funding. For maternal child health, we actually do a lot of home visitation for new moms, and that model could easily be translated into doing home visitation for people with dementias and caregivers. For children's medical services, we have a robust care coordination program where it really makes sure that people are getting the right services, evidence-based care for vulnerable children with certain diagnoses. Perhaps something like that could be switched over to addressing Alzheimer's disease. And then so a big one, and you're seeing more and more attention to with the wildfires and how people with dementias were disproportionately impacted by those and other major disasters. And so this is something, as we do planning for big public health emergencies, to really focus on people with dementia and their caregivers as a group that we need to be working with. And then finally, in chronic disease and injury prevention, there's just a lot of work that we're doing there. I mean, people were mentioning right now, what is the state of the science, what helps to prevent Alzheimer's, and some of the nutrition. We have nutrition education obesity prevention programs. We're doing more planning for healthy communities. And so a lot of that work would translate into things that could really have an impact on this Alzheimer's epidemic. Some local health departments also operate and oversee things like environmental health, animal control shelters, so some encouraging research about the effects of animals on people with and families living with Alzheimer's. We have public hospitals, medical clinics, jail medical services, homeless services, substance use disorder prevention programs. So all these things are opportunities to do more to address Alzheimer's. So the challenges is always for local public health is funding. Typically, we have limited funding in general, but also even less funding that's discretionary that we can kind of spend on what we want to. So we have very narrow scopes of work and what we're supposed to be working on. Most health departments, as I mentioned, don't receive any dedicated funding to address dementia. But we still, and this is really where you can really be an advocate for us doing something on dementia. We have a responsibility to maintain public health essential services and kind of the core elements of public health. So most public health officers and officials that you'll talk to will recognize the need to be doing more, but they may not feel like they have the resources to really address this problem on a scale that's really on a response that's proportional to the size of the problem. This is just a slide looking at the essential services and core functions of public health. You may not be able to see that here, but just how our health, our responsibilities are organized into assessment, policy development, and assurance as the core functions, and then we have the 10 essential services of public health that are related to that. I won't go into each one, but just to say that as a plug for, I have a prop here. So the Healthy Brain Initiative put out this roadmap. It's called the State and Local Public Health Partnerships to Address Dementia. And every local public health officer, thanks to Susan here, has a copy of this. Right, so they've received this. They probably have it in a file somewhere, but they have this. You can bring them another one. You can order, I think, online through CDC and or the Alzheimer's Association, I believe, and get a copy of this. But really, it has lots of very actionable things that local public health and state public health can be doing. So it has an action agenda of 25 ways state and local public health and the partners can pursue goals of the Healthy Brain Initiative. These are aligned with the public health essential services, so kind of put in a way that the public health people can understand them and what we can do about it and how it relates to our responsibilities. And then they're actually organized within each essential service. They're categorized into risk identification and reduction, diagnosis and quality of care, caregiving, education and training for professionals, and data and evidence for action. This is a busy slide, but just is more of a brainstorming. And I know when we talk and get to the panel discussion, can think about ways that we can start to weave or braid these different funding streams or responsibilities at the public health, at the local public health level to address dementia and aging-related issues. But I already mentioned sort of this, we're already doing epidemiology and surveillance, but not really for dementias, and that's something that we could build into what we're currently doing. I mentioned our community health assessment and community health improvement strategic planning processes where we do lots of working with the community and talking to the community and prioritizing and coming up with plans, and we need to do more of talking about Alzheimer's and other dementias. Health promotion and injury prevention programs, we're doing more in health and planning. So a lot of what we're doing like around climate change and designing communities that are resilient to climate change. We also, I think that will help in having planned communities for people, you know, and families with dementia. I mentioned before the public health emergency preparedness and response. And really, this is a crisis, and actually, the other, in some ways, dementia reminds me of climate change. It's something that we've, kind of this epidemic that we've seen coming for decades. I remember the late 80s, I wasn't very old then. I wrote a research paper for school on climate change, which was at the time called global warming. And I mentioned to you, back in the 90s, I was really interested, you know, because of my grandmother in Alzheimer's. So me, you know, I personally have seen this like coming for 20 or 30 years. Unfortunately, the you know, for climate change, like it's happening now. So and we're having to manage the impacts of that. I remember as a, you know, 20 years ago, applying to medical school, really being hopeful about we're going to have treatment for Alzheimer's, you know, by the time I'm in practice. And unfortunately, like, we have some treatments out there, but this epidemic, it's hitting now. The baby boomers are, you know, in their 70s. And so in some ways, it's they're analogous for me. Is how do we manage the impacts now? At the same time, how can we, like, address climate change and prevent it from being worse? How can we do all the great things, you know, as far as getting a research budget? But, you know, we're going to have impacts in the next decade. I think we're waking up to climate change and seeing, you know, these terrible wildfires and some of these impacts now. I think that that's starting to happen. I know you all are on the front lines of this, seeing in your communities the impact of dementias right now. I mentioned before the home visitation and peer support programs. You know, so public health typically doesn't have responsibility for mental health. I'm the only health officer in California who's a psychiatrist, so I'm the medical director for our behavioral health system and have some role in understanding of those programs. I think there's a lot of opportunities there. It's good to understand that mental health care, it's very fragmented everywhere, but especially in California. So each county is its own managed care plan for mental health for people with Medi-Cal. And there's not enough resources anywhere. And so what ends up happening is we're really restrictive and say we're going to focus these resources on the people who meet criteria who we're here to serve. So dementias are, they're, you know, in the our psychiatry considers them to be mental disorders, but the mental health plans aren't really set up. It's not a diagnosis that we're supposed to be treating alone. So, but of course, if you have a dementia plus another mental illness, you are eligible for services. There's a lot of re-education. You know, a lot of the county workers on the front lines don't really understand this distinction that they can serve people with dementias if they meet other criteria to get services. I bring this up because there's a huge amount of funding here, and actually a lot of the interventions that we use at the county level to address other mental illnesses can be really helpful in addressing Alzheimer's. I know we were talking about how come this discussion about how come doctors aren't screening for dementia, how come they're not talking to their patients, there's this stigma about talking to patients with dementia. It's all the same. I remember, you know, trying to do this in Fresno, screening for depression in primary care. It's kind of a lot of the same issues. So we don't have the time. If we find it, what are we going to do? There's this stigma. I'm going to break down the doctor-patient relationship if I tell my, you know, patient that they're crazy, et cetera. And so the interventions we have through, like, the Mental Health Services Act, that's the tax on income over $1 million. So that was a ballot initiative that's now about 15 years old and has had tremendous impact on mental health services in California. There's a portion of those dollars that are aimed towards prevention and early intervention and towards things like stigma reduction and changing the community's ideas about mental illness. Those types of things I really can see being helpful, especially targeted interventions to targeted communities to break down stigma directed towards dementias. I mentioned housing programs, multi-purpose senior services programs, which some health departments run. I know there's some of those providers here. Adult Protective Services, Public Guardian. So all these different programs really have opportunities to influence and build. We can build a system through, what we call a collective impact model, where we bring all these different pieces of the puzzle together. Maybe public health being the backbone for that, and seeing what everybody's doing, and not duplicating efforts, but also making sure, seeing what gaps we have in our system. So some best practices in addressing dementia as a public health issue. Public health involvement in dementia-friendly communities. Again, this is the dementia-friendly communities is this public collective impact model idea that focuses around social inclusion, stigma reduction, improving care and services, increasing awareness and empowering people with dementias and their caregivers and their communities to really address these issues. So again, community engagement, partnership, education, incorporating dementia, as I mentioned before, dementia-related measures into our community health assessment and community health improvement plan. Public health, incorporating dementia into our program design and evaluation of programs, improving early detection, training health professionals with things like dementia dialogue. So this is something we have, it was mentioned in my intro that I'm on the board of our medical societies, and that's a real opportunity working with both the California Medical Association and your local medical societies to do more screening, understanding what the barriers physicians may have and trying to address those, and then finally using data to expand caregiver services. So some possible future directions, and I will wrap up. So I mentioned before, we can weave all this funding together, but some additional funding would really help. Especially, we're always, I think public health is chronically underfunded, and we're always going and trying to do more with less and figure out what to prioritize. And so if we're really going to have a response that's proportional to the scale of this epidemic in our communities of dementias, we really do need additional funding directed towards dementia, but also looking at our existing funding streams to see how we can weave this together. I mentioned the dementia-friendly communities. There's a lot of overlap with work that we're already doing, and so as you go advocating at the local level, your local public health officers, you might remind them of that, so we're not starting completely from scratch, that we already have a lot of these resources in place, and that it's just a matter of sort of modifying them to address dementia. So for instance, the dementia-friendly communities has a lot of overlap with the work that they're already doing, planning for having climate change resistant communities. So this idea I put in here, and I haven't really field tested this yet, which I want to get to the questions and bounce this idea off, but we're doing a pilot in Placer County through a waiver program with Medicaid, where Medicaid says, typically Medicaid and Medicare services are kind of fee for service. And I mentioned Medicaid pays for things like long-term care, really expensive high-end, inpatient care, emergency room services. And they said, we'll pay for things that we don't normally pay for, like housing supports for a target population. In our case in Placer, it was for people experiencing homelessness. We'll pay for some of the stuff we don't normally pay for with the idea that it'll save money upstream. And so we've been tremendously successful on this pilot. It's been going for a couple of years on homelessness, and all these savings that we've been able to get is really, if we were a company, these would be profits, and we've been able to invest them back upstream in the things that really help people get better. And for homeless people, that's primarily housing but other supports. And this type of model, I see, given how all these costs that we saw that are looming around dementias, it's got to be part of the solution for how do we have a system. So just kind of paying for end of life care for people with dementia, that's where most of the money is going. It doesn't make sense. So can we start to take some of the money that we're spending right now for care that doesn't really help people and move it upstream to things that do, that maybe aren't more healthcare related, but that are more public health or even working on the social determinants of health. So that's a controversial issue. I only represent myself and not even Placer County on that one. And finally, better collaboration. I think we can always, in Placer County, that's why I went there, We're an integrated health and human services agency, and so in general, we collaborate pretty well across behavioral health, public health, social services. That doesn't always happen in every county in California. And then, working with collaborating with primary care clinics, our Alzheimer's disease centers, our MSSPs, area agencies on aging, hospitals, skilled nursing facilities, assisted living. And then, anyone from the managed care plans here? Yeah, they need to be here. so that's another area where we've had a lot of success in whole person care is getting these people to the table, the big health systems, the big managed care folks, and the community-based organizations, and really deciding who does what. They have profits that they could help to invest in these things too. It'll help their bottom line. So I think just wrapping up, things you can do today, which I think we've already started to talk a little bit about, I mentioned reading your community health assessment and community health improvement plan. That seems really boring, but it won't take long. They're typically pretty short documents. If you want help, I'll be around for lunch too, so if people want help, how do you engage with your local public health officer? I know all of them, and it can even help you on their website find these. Just about every county has one, and see what's in there. Again, you're not going to like what you see, I'm afraid, so there probably won't be a lot towards Alzheimer's and dementias. The good news is we do these every, three or four years. And same, the hospitals do something very similar every 3 years. They're required to. And so this is really an opportunity to get more in there. And then if it's identified in their plan, then they have to report that they're doing something towards these goals. And then identifying some important local data indicators or sources, existing resources and gaps. So I mentioned some that are likely to be there in every community, and so kind of identifying who those people are and getting them to the table. Again, that's something that public health does really well, is kind of serving as this central backbone organization, this convener. And so that's something that as you go out and sell this in your communities, generally, your local public health people, they'll buy that. They'll say, yeah, I can bring people to the table. Don't ask me necessarily to provide a whole bunch of services because I don't have the budget for this, but we can convene people and get them together. And so that's something. But identifying who those people are is an important thing that you can do. And joining, that's kind of the collective impact effort. So joining in with those. There are also existing collective impact efforts, probably not around dementias, but around other things that we in the advocacy community for dementias can start to participate in. So I mentioned Mental Health Services Act. So every county has a process, convening, usually it's once a month, where people get together and they talk about mental health services and talk about stigma reduction and all these different campaigns, and then they divide up this huge, it's the billions of dollars that come through the Mental Health Services Act. Most of that's pushed out to locals, and they have lots of discretion of how they divvy that up. So you should be there at the table as they divvy up the money, right? And also building those relationships and partnerships. And then, like I said, sharing this material. It's already been shared with local public health, but you can share it again. And really being persistent on that, continuing to bring this up, because it's a problem that's not going away, that local public health is increasingly going to have to address. So just being really focused on that, understanding what our limitations are and having kind of some empathy for local public health and what their limitations are. Susan she came to me, was that about a year ago, and did a great job. She should have a toolkit or something, how to approach, local public health with empathy, with understanding, not just starting with, you need to be doing more, but really understanding what it is that, what our struggles are, and then how do we address this together. So be nice, be empathic, but also be persistent, right? So as you advocate. So I have questions here, but actually I think we're going to take questions together as a panel. So I am done, and thank you so much.